snowball the game, which is necessary if you go against a team that is just better on the macro game. SKT comfortable with their choices.
And according to Analyst Desk, a lot of the members felt that for AHQ, their biggest opportunity was in the early game. Get ahead early and use that to steamroll further. Monty?
I'm not sure I agree with that, simply because of the average gold differentials that we've seen between these teams. Right now, SKT usually has a 5,200 gold lead on average at 20 minutes. Meanwhile, AHQ is at negative 329. So there's a 5,500 gold differential in the early game on average. That is a very troubling statistic.
Pretty sure you've just described AHQ's group stage. They're quite swingy in their performances from what we've come to see. They've picked the team comp that's going to either swing in their favor with those double TPs or against them.
I think the door is swinging closed, Quickshot. We'll find out, though. We'll find out. I think this is going to be a good matchup for Faker. He likes to push the lane very aggressively. He's played this entire year. Push the lane, get autos on the turret, take the mid tower, open the map.
Something we have seen, though, from that Diana pick in mid, on paper, it looks like it doesn't push very well, but the teleport solves a lot of the problems this pick faces around level 3 to 4, and then you can definitely solve that a little bit by just basing, getting some more mana, and start wave clearing.
Well, we'll find out how these teams perform on the Rift. You guys at home, for the first time today, is the door open or closed? Hashtag SKT win or hashtag AHQ win. Crowd in London is electric as the tournament favorites, SKT, are taking on number one seed from the LMS, AHQ.
The matchup I'm looking forward to most is actually just Bengi into Mountain. If he actually goes for any mistake in terms of pathing, revealing himself, Bengi has been just on point with punishing those mistakes.
Yeah, interestingly, Faker has decided to take Ignite in this matchup, which is a little bit of a surprise. I don't really think that Ignite Lulu is very good here. Sure, it's going to give you more kill pressure in the mid lane, but he has to capitalize on that. Bengi needs to show up early in order to make the most out of that particular summoner spell choice.
A bit of a show-off here between Wolf and Albus, but a defensive stock across the line. Not a lot of deep vision down within the opening minutes, and Arn already starts to back away.
SKT's playstyle has been very top lane triangle, so top, mid, and jungle focused, while having Bang and Wolf play a relatively even slash passive bot lane overall. They can do that with the Alistar. And also lane swap, AHQ looking to match probably the lane swap they predicted from SKT. SKT having none of that and say, wait, we can take it 2-2.
Pretty passive level 1, actually. We've seen a lot of one-side invades or mirror invades from the teams, but this is going back just to the line of scrimmage, so not something that we've seen very frequently in terms of a level 1 at the World Championship, but looks like nobody wants to take any risks in the quarterfinals.
Why not? You don't want to give AHQ's team comp any sort of advantage, but mirrored starts. Junglers and top laners as well as AD carries and support all on the same camps, just on opposite sides of the map.
Curious what SKT's plan is. They want Westdoor to push in early to open up the possibility of a gank, but what Bengi's timing is going to be is very interesting. Before Diana hits 6, she is more vulnerable than most mid laners to these ganks, and so if you're going to take the Ignite, you have to make the most use of it and actually shut her down in the laning phase, because if you can't follow with TP later, your bot lane's going to have a lot of trouble.
Yeah, look at Marn pathing to the top lane. SKT was not expecting this lane swap to come out. They were just expecting HQ to go bottom and take a slightly unfavorable matchup, 2v2 early. So Marn pathed upwards, found the Thresh in the river, said, oh, we have a lane swap on our hands, but SKT should be fine to adapt.
Let's see what that small up in tempo will do. Faker already shoving the wave into Westdoor, as we expected in this matchup. Westdoor is going to take a lot of harass while trying to CS, and he's going to lose some of those minions.
Yeah, and this is, again, we need to watch the jungle mid synergy between these two teams. So what this is saying, Faker's shoving the lane in because he's trying to buy Bengi more time to get some levels, to get some buffs, and it's going to reverse the pressure onto him now. So it's about how he manipulates the wave right now. It's going to give us a hint as to what their plan is around the mid lane.
Yeah, Faker obviously leaning to the right side, the strong side of the map. That's where the jungler could be. Obviously, Westdoor doesn't know that. Sometimes we see these four-man roams in the mid lane in the tournament as an adaptation to the relatively fast 4v0 push we have. But AHQ and SKT looking to go completely standard on this push.
Not taking any risk. Bang, of course, playing Tristana will have a little bit of a fast pushing advantage. First turret.
And this is a change because over in LCK, we very often saw Marn just go back to the lane early, try soak experience, and not get punished for that. But it seems the Western lane swap style has kind of made its way to Worlds as a standard here, where both teams just straight a tower, bounce the way backwards. either top laner and AD carry will share now for pickaxe gold, but the Koreans are actually fine just buying Avarice, so they don't even care about the pickaxe.
Very greedy of them. But yeah, coming into this, and we do see it's the European lane swap style, of course, with the jungler still going on the strong side, close to the majority of the members of the team to continue farming. So it is the EU that's won out.
Always stole the gold. It's like, Ziv, you don't need that gold. Sharing is caring.
Small advantage then to Marit in terms of getting that local gold. Tower's not even fallen yet, actually, so it's going to get shoved in.
Marit intentionally bounced the wave off of that, looks like. Looks like it barely didn't die right now. So a bit of an error in the lane swap would appear from SKT.
And this is something we see with teams that are just not as practiced in doing over and over and over. When that last minion dies, suddenly the armor on that tower goes up again because the backdoor bonus comes back. And then that one hit that you were doing will be two hits or three hits.
A small advantage to AHQ in terms of the global gold. Ziv and Marin both TP'd up to the top lane, and the wave is pushing towards Ziv. As long as he doesn't throw down those decimates too frequently, play a little safe.
It's good adaptation from Ziv.
Aggressive play as well, connects to the Apprehend. Mountain with an optimistic burrow. There's no tower, no cooldown on Apprehend. So Marin says, I dare you, bro. That you're gonna push them out.
The awkward gank actually coming in.
It's not over yet. Now Marin's caught up. Furious bite. Again, Ziv needs to get in range. Down in the bottom lane. Arn's going forward. This is the man that we're talking about. Wolf down to 100 HP. Double flake. He's gonna keep bang back. Flash and heal and exhaust used for everything on the side of AHQ.
A bit of a mistake there from Arn popping his Rent, not taking into account that Bang still had heal available to keep his support alive because he could have got two more Rent stacks, maybe then finished him off.
Good aggressive play from AHQ, both top and bottom. There is still a flash available. Ooh. Bang, he's going to rocket jump forward. Arn's got that explosive charge on his head. Albus and Arn, they're moving forward, but just to trade it. Coming away better from AHQ.
Yeah, you can see the change that was done to Alistar W. This tower is low, so you should play as if it's not even there because Bengi's diving.
It's 3v2, the tower's down. Albus will give up first blood. Bang, bang, he wants to shoot them down. He's rocket jump forward. Bang's looking for the double. His 73 KDA, and the hunt for 100 is on.
Bang, bang, is Bengi shot them down? I think that's how that one should go.
But damn, yeah, just, it, Monty!
it's a very easy dive on that turret with it being so low. It wasn't really respected, but if we watched Bengi's pathing coming in, comes in around the mid lane, gets a pink ward in, walks, so he's very, very safe in his assumption about where Rek'Sai can be while simultaneously giving Faker the ability to play to the right side and pressure the turret.
So he's not greedy. He flashes for the cocoon. A lot of junglers here were just path around, trying to get an easy cocoon, preserving the flash. And this time, Wolves lands that combo. Earlier, he missed it a little because obviously Alistar W got changed. A lot of these supports just have the muscle memory from the old combo. But it lands a more important one. Two kills here on the board for SKT.
Yeah, although things went well for SKT on the bottom side, in the top side, Marin's found himself getting a bit denied right now due to the little bit of an error in the early game and Mountain's pressure on the top side. So it's a bit of a deficit that Marin's going to have to overcome in this matchup. And Mountain's still playing the top side right now, but he is in trouble.
He really is. Marin is, as is Bengi and Wolf. Mountain is going to stick around. He's going to manage to find his way a second tunnel. There's another one ready, and Mountain gets out.
Well, tunnel vision on that grump, but he makes it out anyways.
Ooh. Well, good setup for that, but Bengi missing the skill shot really hurt right there. Couldn't really do anything about that. Bold play from Mountain for the grump, I will say. Makes me a bit nervous to see players do that, but he does get away with it.
Gentlemen, Mountain, as well as Ziv, got themselves an advantage over their opposite numbers, but Faker, 20 CS up over Westor at 7 minutes. And Bang with a pickaxe and an Avarice Blade to the Vamp Scepter of Arn.
Problem with these junglers reverting to the side lanes, it just gives Faker an easy matchup where he doesn't get punished. Wester doesn't have the damage to take him down in one go, so he needs the assistance of his jungler, but he's busy trying to snowball top lane against Marn, one of the best, if not the best player in the tournament so far.
And you know, Faker here, we talked about the CS differentials between Faker and Wester. Wester at negative 17 and a bit of a ground player from Atlas, but Faker up at plus 16. So if this holds true at 10 minutes, we should see a 33 differential if the averages are going to be appearing in this particular matchup.
It appears to be the case for now. Approaching 10 minutes on the clock, and nobody's really made a big move for Dragon. You can see Bengi on the mini map, pulling some support from Faker as well with the deep vision they've got set up. This team could opt to challenge around that objective.
And what SKT does well as a team is they don't buy into the traditional, okay, two members should always be in a bot lane, one guy should always be in the top lane. They redistribute their resources well enough to keep their losing lanes from snowballing further. Look at Wolf, who just showed up at the left side of the map randomly before, or looked randomly, with a purpose obviously, to then go back to the bot lane. Now he's helping Bengi take a blue buff down, and they're just working together as a squad.
Marin says, I don't really need the squad. Throws down a grand challenge onto Ziv, trying to run him down. Ziv is now got Noxian Might. He flashes with the apprehend. Riposte has been charged, and both players trade ultimates, rather just flashes. Ziv's holding onto the dunk. But SKT Dragon.
Skirmishing on the opposite side of the map, nothing really happening right there. Marin being a little bit bold, he didn't have any vision on that top side of the map.
He was looking to pop the last vital there for the heal, but Ziv did enough damage. Here's Mountain though.
Mountain, oh, that's a mistake. Maybe attack moved onto the Grom. Now he's in trouble. Does manage to tunnel, gets a double knockup. Ziv is going to look for the heal on the Decimate. Wolf's in trouble. There's no unbreakable. And Wolf's going to be able to get away as Ziv had already used Apprehend.
Yeah, that's the difference with you. Potentially a double killer for AHQ. You can't afford to make those mistakes against SKT.
A bit rough, but you know he still had his ultimate, so it was going to be a bit hard to go in on that, but they are going to lead this mid lane up. Bang is already in the mid lane. Of course, they have the ranged jungler release, one of the best combos here for quickly taking a turret. And so that little gank deep in SKT territory will be punished with the mid lane.
Yeah, SKT, they don't want to style on their opponents in a sense where we just want to outplay a 2v2. No, we use the pressure we have in lane to push up the lanes, and then we just outnumber you in another lane. Pushed in the bot lane there by Bang, moves to the mid lane, sees the tower, picks up the farm in the bot lane. All is well on SKT side.
Monty, you talked about the gold lead SKT has had on average at 10. Currently, it's just over 2,500. Analysts there talk about the dragons. SKT have secured 19, and they've only given up one across their 7 games. And their average game time is 29 minutes. So they're getting, on average, 3 dragons a game, below 30-minute average win time. These are exceptional stats for SKT.
I mean, they're absolutely incredible, right? To have that much control over the dragon, each game, that means on average that they take 3 dragons and their opponents take 0.17. So you're lucky to get, you know, a very small fraction of a dragon when you play against them.
Maybe that's AHQ's goal this game.
Get dragon.
Just get one dragon to ruin SKT stats. Kill Bang like once or twice to ruin his KDA and then go home.
I have to kill him a few more than just once to ruin that KDA. Although, one more time, we'll cut it in half. Only single death conceded. Mountain is sniffing out Wolf, who's still not level 6. There's no support for Mountain.
You can see Wolf just intelligently waiting right here till his jungler and his AD carry get into the top side of the map. Not taking any risks walking forward until he has backup and then heading around to cut off in the tribe rush.
SKT is sending Faker down to the bot lane. 4 people in the top. Wester has teleport. Faker is running the Unite, so this could potentially be a 4v5 here in the top lane.
If
or 4v4 actually.
Teleports. Never mind. Let's take a look. SKT decide to back away. And Faker's moved down to the bottom to deal with the pressure Arn was applying. Arn silently farming up a sizable lead in CS as Bang has swapped around the map to put tower pressure down. He got the mid tower earlier and now looking towards that top tower.
And look what they did. They sent Faker to defend to the far side against Arn. Then mid lane wasn't pushed in because Wester wasn't certain, then Marin just TP's there. So SKT just not sticking to the regular roles. And for AHQ, if they want to find an opening here, we just need Wester to get behind people with the teleport and surprise them. Just assassinate them, make picks.
Especially with 2 TP's up right now to none, this is a golden opportunity for AHQ to really get into this game and start to make plays on the map. But you can see how cautious SKT was just sending those 4 people top. They knew they were going to be extending deep at least for a moment, so they wanted as much backup there as possible, respecting the double teleports. And, you know, in Korea, when SKT lost 1 best of 3 over the course of the summer season, it was because they were not respecting double globals when they played against CJ Entis. I can really see there's a big difference right now in the way they are playing the map compared to that loss against CJ.
Also, just how far up their pink wards are in this game. Usually you see them defensively at the entrance of your jungle. They have one here to try to push behind Bank to spot a Rek'Sai flank, one on the Scuttle Crab, and they're just defending there as well. A lot of these teams, they place pink wards and then they leave the area.
Albus is sitting Bang. He's gonna eat a death sentence and gets pulled into the box. Apprehend his channel in the play. Cancels the rocket jump. The dunk comes down from Ziv, but it's Albus that secures the kill. Unbreakable Will is available for Wolf. He will flash over the wall. And AHQ will not chase further. They've got their first kill.
And it also ruins Bang's KDA, cutting it right in half down to what, a measly 36 right now. So he's not actually going to hit the 100 mark anymore, unless we have some very interesting games in this best of five.
Interesting may be the name. Flays backwards, pulls on forwards. There's nowhere to go. Bengi flashes over the wall. One from Arn, looking for the Pierce. Renz for a kill and throws Albus for good measure.
And this is exactly what AHQ is looking for, making picks without plays, using that play to cancel the rocket jump after Ziv already used the apprehend. Now Westor, he should be able to do some damage to Marn in the bot lane.
Gonna force him away for the time being. The London crowd supporting the underdog. Mountain is being forced away by Faker, and all of a sudden AHQ have a momentum swing in their favor. They're still down in gold.
And they're down in control on the map too. They're down in that dragon. We can take a look at this little play again.
Yeah, Hook comes out, and now they have two cancels for Rocket Jump. So Ziv does a smart thing, just using his to get more damage, and then the Flay. On paper, it's easy, but to do this in a tournament against a player like Bang, whoever tries to mind game, you know this is a good player, you know he's not going to instant rocket jump, so you need to predict it.
Really was nice communication there between the Flay and the Apprehend, like you're saying, to make sure that only one of those was used initially to pull him in, get him a little bit closer so you can get the damage down, and then saving the other for that rocket jump. Great execution by AHQ.
And thank you, stats guys. Bang has spent 27 seconds dead out of the 220 minutes of gameplay SKT have had at the World Championship.
Probably ask the referee, like, guys, why is my screen gray? Guys, is this a bug? Oh, tick, tick.
Someone turn the filter off. SKT will get their second dragon of the game. No contest from AHQ.
Problem is for AHQ, whenever they make a pick, they have a hard time capitalizing on objectives because SKT plays such a high-pressure style. They're always doing something. Their vision is so far up, so even when you kill somebody, the route you take to the next objective. Here's Bang, actually reporting that bug.
Reporting the gray screen bug. Well, we are in London, so it is awfully gray. You know, in general, sometimes I think I'm dead when I'm outside.
I saw the sun yesterday for 10 minutes, I swear. It was there. So we do have a brief pause as we've crested 15 minutes. AHQ maybe slowed down some of the pressure that SKT was putting on them, but the vision is still fairly in favor of SKT, and Mountain's got a good tunnel network that he's been using to his advantage.
Yeah, and Westor doing the prime strategy not to die against Faker. Don't lane against him, just go to a different lane.
Split push against Fiora instead, try and get Marin down. And they're holding out their own so far, and they're playing the kind of game that I think they need to play to be successful here, because team fighting against SKT's composition in the late game isn't really an option. Once Fiora gets that heal down, if Fiora gets wild growth in the middle of a fight, that is absolutely terrifying. A fed Fiora can just tear through an enemy team.
Yeah, definitely so. On and Albus have been playing well, though, so far.
Yeah.
A couple of plays in the bot lane, forcing double flash, then they make a play. Every death so far from SKT has been at the hands of Albus. Initial hook there in the top lane, flashing in for a Flay there when Bengi was in the river. So overall, they're not afraid to make aggressive moves. They may just have to ramp it up a little bit more if they really want to snowball early game.
Well, 15 minutes in, they're going to run out of time before that early game is officially over. Ziv, as you can see on your screen right now, he is having an issue with his monitor. The tech guys believe it is resolved. They're just doing some checks and tests on stage before we resume the game. And Ziv, 10 CS down. He had a higher CS advantage early in the game. But Bengi showed some love. There was some support from Bang and Wolf. And Marin was able to farm up that difference.
Well, they've also been using teleport for farm, right? We've seen AHQ holding on to their TPs to potentially set up plays. But there was no hesitation when we saw the Fiora TP right into the mid lane to collect that wave. We've seen SKT just holding firm, having a freeze at a tier 2 turret. They've been really, really focusing on getting this CS on Marin, and that's really been the story of this tournament so far. Marin has the highest gold per minute of any player at 448, and SK Telecom is the only team in this tournament where the top laner gets a higher percentage of gold than either the mid or the AD carry. Actually, both the mid and the AD carry. Sometimes one or the other, but never like both of them with a higher percentage.
Marin has been hard carrying so many of these games, and SKT have just been outclassing their opponents through many of their laning phases.
But this may change this game, however, because Marin was slightly behind in the lane swap, and Faker, he was phenomenal at CSing overall. 31 CS up at 10-minute mark here against his opponent, Westor, who now has said, well, I like my CS on another lane. I don't want to battle that Ignite Lua for it. I'm just going to avoid you. And SKT hasn't really played to the strengths of the composition just yet, which is group sieging. Having Marn split push, drawing somebody away on that Fiora for duelist, and then just sieging with that composition, throwing out cocoons. Bang only needs like 5 seconds with a tower, and it'll be gone in 20 minutes.
Well, for AHQ, they do have some strengths in Ziv and Ahn. We'll see whether or not the two of them can pull enough attention from SKT as we rejoin the game. Mountain forced to flash away, still playing maybe overly aggressive in SKT territory. Not enough support from the rest of the Korean squad, so AHQ get out. They do lose a summoner.
Just one down though, and Mountain has been living in that topside jungle, really making it difficult. And if you're playing on the red side against blue side with Faker on it, that's where you want to go. You want to attack his blue buff so he doesn't have the lane pressure.
And you have to do that because you need the deep wards, because if ASQ is going to make any proactive TP plays, you need vision behind enemy lines. And that's what they're looking for right now. That's phase one of the plan. Get that vision. Lure him out and then surprise him somehow with the double TP.
So, Grand Challenge is down again. Marin gets away, forced to flash. Ziv is looking for the decimate. That burn's not going to be enough. And Ziv, again, coming out better in the trade. Faker, he's going to wild growth up. Westor gets the reset on the Crescent Strike. He's got that Pale Cascade shield to prevent some of the damage, but Faker comes away looking better after the fight. HQ are not done yet, gentlemen. They look to contest this red buff, and they're not backing away. Fate's Call is available, but Bengi will smite it. At least it's a resource denied from back.
They're getting control of the jungle, but they have to start taking these turrets, so they are going to smoothly move down into that bottom side, start getting some damage, and SKT tries to get an angle to defend.
If this goes bad, though, there's a ward all the way behind them that Mari can teleport to.
Ziv has his TP up as well, and SKT defend the tower, defending their 1,500 gold as well.
They can shut SKT off, though. They've removed a lot of resources to defend that bot lane tower, but now they have no wave clear in the mid lane, so that should be open, and this is exactly what they were looking for. Using the pressure from that pick potential to zone them out of the jungle, they can then take an inefficient route, and now Ziv, he gets back in time for the top lane.
Yeah, just catches that wave right there. Makes sure that Marin can't split push down the tower, so some really good moves on the map from AHQ right here. Just getting into both sides of the jungle, making sure they set up the vision, and then cutting off SKT's defenses properly. This has been a really well-played series of events, and it's put AHQ back in this game now, only down 1,000. They've been slowly recovering that gold differential.
Yeah, some good rotations here.
Very good, in fact.
AHQ are gonna need a few more of those magical moments if they wanna get a lead. They are still down. Marin has got that Hydra completed. A Ziv is gonna apprehend him back, but Decimate comes up. Grand Challenge again is thrown down. Noxian Might is burning. Ziv's looking for a target, but there's no flash to follow. But Ziv, once again, winning the duel with Marin.
And he's doing a good job not exposing his vitals to Marin to get that heal on that ultimate, so he just really wants to keep his torso, you know, aligned with Marin's. You're not going to stab me in the side or back, maybe put one vital overall. And by the time Marin could be done with it, he's already dead.
Oopsie. Still just missing that pink ward. He moves into the blue buff area. Faker still pushing down the bottom lane. So AHQ win a fight up top, but gonna lose a lot of hit points on this inner turret.
And there's no teleport wards again. They really need to start placing deep wards when they leave a lane. Instead of focusing all the wards in the jungle, they should push up the lane, leave a ward there, because somebody's gonna push it out again, and then you can surprise them, because nobody expects lane wards. Everybody expects jungle wards for teleport. On the lane, that's where you make those proactive key plays. And Westor, I don't think he's used teleport almost a single time, maybe just to get back to lane once.
Yeah, there really hasn't been that proactive. They've been making plays without teleport, which is great, but they haven't taken every single opportunity that they could to snowball their lead or try and get back into this game, rather. And one thing that we really haven't talked about yet is what this is going to look like in the late game. So SK Telecom, if we just look at their composition, AHQ is eminently kiteable here. They have a very low engage composition. Westor can get in there once, but he's going to have a hard time following him after that. And when we're talking about champions with a high amount of mobility, Fiora, we have Lulu with the kiting, the Glitter Lance. It's going to be very hard to actually teamfight for AHQ lane.
Luckily, SKT have found Mountain in the jungle. Teleport's coming in from Westor. Zip's in a little bit of trouble. The Wild Growth is up as well. And Bengi just gets one. Marin, Iska arrived to the party after teleporting in, but that was just too easy.
I mean, just coming in off of that, they set it up well with Wolf. It comes back to the wards they got deep in the jungle earlier on. They did a great job of sweeping it out and just following up on the wave. And finally, AHQ tries to make a TP play, but they do it while Marin has his as well. And so it's just not the same effectiveness that we could have seen earlier in this game.
Yeah, headbutt into double pulverizer from Wolf, not weaving that combo in together, just maximizing the cooldown on that, and then just focusing on Rek'Sai for the reset. Really good ult, just utility from Alistar right there. And later on in these fights, later in the game, when Westor is diving in, Wolf can actually trade his life and can stay alive for long enough with that Unbreakable to just trade his life with any of these carries of AHQ, and then it's going to get rough for AHQ to find an answer, so they really need to start making better picks.
A lot of pressure on AHQ. Inner turret on the bottom lane does stay standing. Small solace, but lost control of their jungle, lost control of the tempo of the game, and with Dragon up in 20 seconds, SKT have got pretty good vision. Phenomenal vision even in the blue side area of AHQ to allow them to set up for that Dragon. It's finally Westor secures that outer turret to the bottom lane.
Yeah, and they started with a turret deficit. Now AHQ has made good use of the split push to take a turret advantage, and this is what they have to do because they cannot fight. They have no way to kill Bang in the late game. Once the rocket jump comes in, he's got the Buster Shot too to get targets away from him. So AHQ is just going to be absolutely kited to death. SKT, what do they want to do? Keep stacking dragons. Right now, just get to the dragon on time, get the priority on that objective, and just kite out AHQ when they contest.
Because after three or four dragons, it would actually put priority on AHQ actually having to stop the dragon. That will lead to a team fight. That's where SKT is stronger. If you want to do dragon, not only do you get a lot of benefits in those team fights from those stats, you also just force the enemy team to fight you over a dragon eventually, unless you can close in 30 minutes. HQ will not be able to do that.
Yeah, and again, SKT gets the priority on the dragon. Bang is there. Here comes the TP.
Ziv is going to look for a party. The death sentence finds no one, but Westor's looking for a flank. Wolf has gone forward. Unbreakable will time out shortly, and Westor forced to flash defensively. Bang zoned him away. Dragon still standing and ticking. Albus looks for Marin and interrupts the lunge. The Wild Growth will save him for a few seconds longer. Ziv on the front line, but as Mountain gets away, the Grand Challenge heal is up. Marin gets apprehended forward. Still on the back line. The ring is going to get ready shortly. Marin eats a decimate. He will go down. A 2-for-1. And AHQ may get Dragon.
Oh, that was so close. That hook from Albus almost tugged Bang back into that fight. And SKT is actually one of the teams that fights incredibly well 4v5. They're not afraid to re-engage or take a fight where people overreach to clean them up and punish them. That was almost a turnaround, but solid play from AHQ overall.
Yeah, and Westor had that flank in there, which made them unable to follow up on the Wolf engage. That was really the critical part of it. They burned Wolf's ultimate, and they have to keep fighting like that, but Faker's in trouble.
Well, Bang goes forward with that rocket jump. He's gonna get Westor. The explosive charge secures it. Now can rocket jump forward aggressively, and Bang finds two more.
And this is exactly the playstyle that got Bang to that initial 71 KDA. He's not a max range player that just waits at the outskirts of the fight. He's not afraid to jump in, get the reset, get another kill, and then jump out.
And does it perfectly. AHQ did win the dragon fight and secure only the second dragon that SKT have ever conceded at the World Championship. Unfortunately, two more kills to Bang. He's now 4-1-3. Currently sitting 500 gold more than Arn. And we'll extend that once they knock this tower down.
Yeah, but Arn's been doing a great job of taking that empty lane farm. We've seen while Marin has been far back near his tier 2 turrets, so is Arn this entire game. So it's kept him relevant, even though Bang has gotten quite fed already. So now that gold lead will extend to about 700, but considering we're talking about 1-1-2 versus 4-1-3, that's actually not too bad.
Certainly is not. Static Shiv has now been completed for Bang. Marin continuing that split push threat on the bottom lane.
It's almost getting to a point where a minor loss against SKT you can view as a win. Oh guys, we're only 800 gold behind.
I mean, to be fair, AHQ have had some pretty good moves this game. They out-rotated SKT to secure some towers. They won a team fight around the dragon pit to secure the dragon. Problem is, they're giving up too much in between those positive plays. It's allowing SKT to maintain control.
And we really haven't seen Faker use this Ignite to any effect, and as the game drags on, they'll have fewer and fewer ways to deal with AHQ's split push, so that is a bit concerning at this point in time.
Let's take a look. Apprehend does not find Bengi. I'm going to use that blade active, but I'm not going to get anything more, and Bengi will clear tunnel and a ward on the way out.
Something we haven't seen from the Ignite, obviously, is the pressure it puts on Westor. Westor may have just not gone on in certain all-ins because of the threat of the Ignite. That is obviously a hard thing to to see, because those are like invisible plays. The same way some people don't go for certain farm because they're afraid of potential teleport. It's incredibly hard to get into the minds of these players. Maybe that's why Faker took it. We can only guess, but not want to question Faker. Not after I went against him once in a vote saying Royal Club would win. Never again. Never in my life.
Long time ago, back when Monty was still driving trains.
There's no hype train this year, you know. I mean, the hype is real. It's manifest.
It's absolute.
Yes, it's the reality train now.
I like that. The reality train.
The Korean dominance reality
that
train.
That makes you a reality star, Monty Cristo.
I don't know how I feel.
Is that an upgrade or a downgrade?
No. That makes me feel very bad about myself. Thank you.
SKT were able to knock over the mid inner turret, while AHQ regained some control of their blue buff, but they're still hemorrhaging gold, hemorrhaging farm, and being forced deeper and deeper back into their own lanes.
And this wave clear coming out of SKT just pushes AHQ back. As a result, they can't get deep wards. Without deep wards, they can't set up teleport plays. They can only play reactionary on teleport. SKT is too good of a team to really get caught. And slowly but surely, they advance their gold lead until Baron becomes an option really on the table. And SKT, they don't go for those early Barons. They only take Barons when they want to close out the game. In 4 out of 6 games, they actually smash the Nexus with the Baron buff still on them. Just shows just how they value that objective.
Yeah, the first Baron buff, nonetheless. So, yeah, just taking
not any, just like the single first Baron they took. Baron to Nexus is 3 minutes. It's like a race for SKT against themselves. It's like one of those ghosts in Mario Kart.
Turn on the 3 minute clock and see what happens. Well, trying to defend here, but again, the wave clear still pretty close to that turret, so they keep getting bottled up. They only have a single ward in that bottom side jungle right now.
Extended siege here for SKT. There's not enough close wards behind them for Ziv and Westor to make use of, and SKT will just face tank to secure their 5th tower kill of the game and increases the gold lead to 5,000. Allows them to set a vision, minutes and a half till Dragon. There's even going to be wards for SKT to play with and force that next Dragon fight if they so choose.
It's a quick recall. Get that gold down, start turning it into items. Looks like Faker going to be going for Witchbane here. So trying to maximize his auto attack damage does make sense, considering he's going to get a lot of autos simply because of his kiting potential against HQ's composition.
And HQ, they're just going to run straight at SKT too, so he's going to weave in a lot of auto attacks. Skullcrab buys him 90 seconds of time.
Small advantage for HQ around the Baron Pit. SKT have made no real moves towards that area. And you know, on 270 CS, 3 items completed. He is going against Bang with the same 3 items, but gonna need to be the man that can fight SKT or Marin more specifically.
You can already see
if you want to win a fight.
You can already see the emphasis SKT is putting on that mid lane control right now. Faker doesn't want to let anybody move up far enough to challenge him on that push, because that is always step one to securing an objective that is either Dragon or Baron. It's pushing in the mid lane first. Then you can go to the side to put deep vision. SKT already had the deep vision, so all they have to do is push mid, go Dragon.
Baron set up on the bottom side already. Ziv actually coming in from behind.
Teleport, first proactive player.
It's gonna be a little difficult. Challenge is down. 2v1 for the time being, but the rest of SKT are nearby. Ziv flashes forward. Wild Growth will interrupt the Noxian Guillotine, but Marin is still low. Westor's looking for Faker. Remember, Wild Growth has been used. Westor goes golden. Wolf is gonna immediately get rid of that death sentence, and the first kill will be Marin down. AHQ looking to retreat. A lot of their tools have been used, and Bang's got a red buff. Crescent Strike connects. Death Sentence does not. Bang flashes forward. It's going to be a Fate's Call to save Albus's life. And Bang rocket jumps. He's got 1 crit onto Ahn. Ahn uses that heal. And it's a 1-0, but AHQ should lose Dragon.
Yeah, they're just going to go right back. I mean, so many members of AHQ just chunked out right there on the retreat, thanks to the Whimsy catching up that Tristana. And Marin's up at 15. He's still got teleport. Let's see if AHQ, they're actually going to contest this. Ziv coming in.
Dragon secured by SKT. Bengi with a respect flash over the wall. And there's even blue pings on Baron. Do AHQ risk rushing?
They could actually consider it, seeing how far they're behind and how they lost that fight, even after getting initial pick. What worries me the most is that they actually had Ziv snuck in that brush. Marin was not aware. They could have teleported Westor 2 seconds, 3 seconds, 4 seconds earlier for that finally proactive play. But it still was a reactive play. He waited for them to start fighting, then he teleported in. So there's a distinct lack of communication here on AHQ side.
And they invested so much too. Look at the number of wards around that Dragon. They still ended up losing it. The Baron Pit is totally dark right now, and SKT, they start to play the top side of the map, they start to push it out. They don't want any wards getting in there. They're trying to force a fight. The best thing SKT can do with this composition against HQ, force a face check, walk backwards, deal the damage, clean it up with Tristana resets.
SKT, it sounds so easy, but they've played safe, and despite being caught a little bit off guard, this is one of the more competitive games SKT have had to deal with at the World Championship. HQ showing they're almost there. They cannot afford any more mistakes at all.
We've talked a lot about SK Telecom, but the fact is they had a relatively easy group. And with EDG not looking anywhere near their former selves at MSI, it was tough to get a read on how good they would actually be. And HQ, they have given us the most competitive game of the tournament so far.
Yeah, take a look at what Bengi and Wolf are doing together. Not only do they roam the map together, Bengi bought the more expensive items that the team needed, as in Locket of the Iron Solari, whereas Wolf is heavily invested more in Vision. He even has two Pink Wards in his inventory right now. A lot for dynamic Vision. We'll get to that later, though, because Westor...
I think he's down. Ziv will be nearby, but I'm not sure he wants to be. The heal from the challenge will just top off any damage that was put down.
Yeah, SKT is just willing to take a pick and then move up their lines of Vision. That's why Wolf is bringing two Pink Wards to the party, so he can continuously keep moving them for optimal positions, and then eventually SKT could secure this Baron.
Might be a little risky. All of HQ are nearby. 3,000 hit points. Wolf is trying to get rid of Mountain. He's interrupted him for a while. The Apprehend pulls Marin back, but that's not the one you want. Exhaust is down onto Ziv. Bang's looking for Arn. The Flay will not find a target. Marin, he'll get a heal from the Summoner spell and stay alive. Bang's looking forward. Ziv will get shut down after being turned into a Munchkin. SKT get Baron and two more kills.
Yeah, Wolf should be playing Goalkeeper Alistar. He's really keeping everybody out of the fight.
And just coming into that fight too, that was all a function of SKT having the vision control on that top side. Westor should not have been pushing out so far by himself. That was a huge error, and SKT is a team. They can turn that one pick into a Baron. They're not going to give you a chance to get in there because Wolf will play that goaltender. He'll be on the backside shoving your jungler out.
Gentlemen, the countdown timer has started. T minus 3 minutes until SKT victory. Four of their six wins, that has proven true. Will this be number five?
Yeah, we need one of those 24 clock sounds, you know, at the end. Lost 10 seconds.
What do you got? Make it happen.
But yeah, the amount of closing. SKT only, we talked about it earlier, they have seven barons in their six games, because all they usually need to finish a game is one Baron. That's what they need. One game against EDG, they took two Barons. Closed the game with the second Baron buff still live.
That was the style Baron crap, though. Let's take a look at this one again. So you'll just see Wolf head out. There's a Buster shot actually that goes out first. So actually a bit of a miscommunication there from SKT. But immediately after the Baron, they're over the wall, they're fighting. Exhaust down onto Ziv nice and early. And Bang has the Wild Growth on it. He knows Marin's in trouble. Marin's calling out for this, and just beautiful play as they come and sweep up behind the red pit.
Yeah, Marin walks out of the fight long enough to survive, reposts the next attack, then he gets a shield, then the cavalry comes in with Bang there, not afraid to move in.
Oh!
Hey!
Arn gets almost three shots, summon a heal and flash, but it will cost an inhibitor turret. Albus has been hit by the Glitterlance. Teleport came in from Marin. This battle is split on two fronts. Marin and Bengi will most likely kill Westor. Arn's here, but he's simply too late. Inhibitor's down. Remember that ticking time bomb. SKT are looking towards the Nexus, and Bang is already on it. The minions arrive. The explosive charge will secure one tower. Cocoon buys time for SKT to take down the second tower, and SK Telecom will hold true and finish the game with Baron to go 1-0.
Wow. Well, that was the ending. I didn't think we were actually going to get it that time, Quick Shot, considering they had to pull back pretty early, but they come in about the last 30 seconds of that Baron buff, and they make it happen.
Yeah, SKT ruining their own Baron power play stats because they end before the buff even wears off. So efficient at closing. Tremendous to see.
Bengi's distraught about Bang's KDA right now, apparently.
You have failed me.
34 minutes. It was, this is going to sound like a weird line, but it was one of the slower wins from SKT. I felt they paid AHQ the respect they deserved when it came to pushing the lanes. We didn't see SKT out of position. Unfortunately for HQ, we did see them out of position, and they were punished for it. They lost a Dragon, they lost a Baron, and they can't afford to make those mistakes.
It's so hard, right? Because you make one mistake like that. Westor wasn't even in that big of danger, but because of the vision that SK Telecom had after the Dragon, they had done the setup a couple minutes previously, denied everything with those pink wards, that it makes it extraordinarily difficult to even push up like that. And you make one of those mistakes against SK Telecom. I mean, just looking at their Barons, they get something like 24 minutes is their first Baron in the game. We talk about post 30. You make a mistake, the Baron is theirs, they will close.
And just looking at their plays, SKT's plays on the map post 20 minutes just makes so much sense. It almost looks easy. It's simple when you watch it. Like, they're doing this because that obviously is their next step. And you think, why are teams not countering this? Because they do it so efficiently. Yeah, they're going for Baron. Yeah, they have vision. Okay, Baron's lost.
Yeah, and it's easy for us to take a look at that and say, okay, this is what they're doing. But these guys are trying to play the game, talk to each other with incomplete information, and they're still making these calls 1-2 minutes in advance, setting up everything so beautifully. It's really impressive to watch.
It really is, and I think a little bit of praise